Index tuning describes the task that we have given a database to decide which indices to create. Indices can vastly improve the performance of a database, but it can also vastly make the performance of a database worse if you have too many indices, because they also have to be maintained. In the following, we go through some examples to see what kind of queries can benefit from what kind of indices. Let's assume we have one sample database about the movie rental. So we have customers reserving films. In total, we have the three database tables here: customers, reserved, and film. And you see that there's a common customer ID, and here's a film ID, so you can connect using the relation reserved, you can connect to which film with which title was reserved and which customer did this and where the customer is living. Depending on the selection predicate within our query, we distinguish the following query types. The first one is asking for film ID equals 2. And in this case, film ID is a primary key. So in this case, this is a primary key point query. Point query because it's asking for a specific attribute to be of a certain value. Here, the value is 2. So the film ID should be 2. We can have also point queries for non-primary key attributes. As you can see here, we want to have films where the title is Terminator. There can be multiple, right? And we can have range queries. For instance, here, the rental price should be between 1 and 4. We can have conjunctions of subpredicates. Here, the kind of the movie should be F, and the rental price should be 4. And important here is the end, the logical end. We can have also like a connection of subpredicates using a logical OR. In this example, rental price should be smaller than 2, or the kind of film should be D. So the database system now has the task to decide how to access data from disk in general. So if we have a query execution plan, or the query plan looks like this, we have a projection to certain attributes we're interested in, then we have a selection, and of course we have to read data from a relation R. And of course this plan can be arbitrarily more complicated, having multiple relations, having joins and so on, aggregation, everything. But this one, just for the sake of the illustration of the problem, will do. So now we have the database system, or we have to decide how to execute this plan. And the naive execution is to go and read the tuples from relation R, then filter them based on the predicate, and then projecting on the attributes we want to keep. Yeah. I say brute force because the scan of the relation R is of course expensive, because all of the tuples have to be accessed. Now, if we have knowledge about an index existing that can be used, for instance, we have an index based on ID of relation R, and the selection is asking for ID equals 42, then we don't have to access the entire relation R, but we can put this together, and the database system will execute this purple part by accessing our index and looking up the tuple or tuples with ID 42 from the index directly. So we don't have to scan R entirely. Now, if this query here with 42 is like this, so it's a point query, then we can have an hash index, or we can have a B plus tree index. But as we have seen, hash index cannot be used for range queries. So if we have something like this, where ID is bigger than 42, then we cannot execute this as an index lookup if we have only a hash index available, but we have to again go back and read the entire relation R. and then apply the predicate. If you have a B+ tree index on R, on the relation R, on the attribute ID, yeah, then we can use this index and retrieve the tuples that are qualifying based on the index. And the job of the database system is to decide how to execute now the selections of tuples from a certain relation. And of course, it matters which indices we are creating, so the database system can actually make use of them. Let's consider the following example. So we have our customer of a movie rental system, our customer relation, and we want to have all the customers and all the attributes of the customers for which the following predicate holds. It's a conjunction of three subpredicates. The first one is asking for name is Jensen, the second one asking for street equals Elm, and the third one asks for state equals Arizona. So let's walk through these different indices we can think of to see if they can be useful for this query or not. So the first bullet point here suggests to have an index on name or having an index on street. Can the index on name be used? Can the index on street be used? Yeah, they can be used because we look up a point query here, or we have a point query here, name equals Jensen, so we can use this index and find all tuples with name equals Jensen. And then we go through these tuples and then we're applying the other conditions. Street is Elm and state is Arizona. What if we have an index on street? Can we use this one? Yeah, it's the same story. We look up using the index on street those customers that live in Elm. And then we go through them and filter those out that are not matching the other two subpredicates, names Jensen and state Arizona. Okay, now we have a composite index on name, street, and state. Can this be used? Yes, it can be used. It's perfect. It's exactly made for this query, right? So we can now take the index and query it using Jensen, Elm, Arizona, and the index will guide us to those tuples that qualify the predicate. Next one, can the index on name and street be used? Yes, it can be used. We just take the index and query it using Jensen, Elm. And the index will guide us then to all Jensens living in Elm. And then we have to go through those and identify the ones living in Arizona. Done. Yeah. Next, what about the index on name, street, and city? So the composite index. Can this be used? Yes, we can use it as well. We will query it with name Jensen and street Elm. The city doesn't really matter. So we will take the smallest city or the empty string city, whatever, or null. And then the index will bring us to all those Jensens in Elm. City is ignored. And then we walk through all of these and find the ones that living in Arizona. Last, what about the index on city, name, and street? Can this be used? No, it cannot be used because we don't know how to query the index to find the tuples we are interested in, since the city is not given here in the where clause of the query. Right? So we would need to query the index using the smallest city name. But this would not help us because then we will get all of the customers and we have to go through them to find the ones we care about, namely Jensen, Elm Street, and State Arizona. Right? So this is like, again, what I said. So the first four are applicable. and the last one is not applicable. And it's important to understand why this is the case. Now, overall, I mentioned that the database system has to decide what is like a feasible, so possible, and also cheap way to answer a query. And what is always possible to do is using a linear scan. This is a brute force way. You're reading all the tuples of a relation, and you're applying your predicate, and you're returning those tuples for which the predicate is true. If the data is sorted in the order that is useful for your query, for instance, matriculation number is the sorting order of the file, and matriculation number is also your query attribute, then you can do something like a binary search, yeah, if the data is sorted properly. Well, we have seen, or we discussed already, that this is not what you should do in a database system with data being on a disk. Then we can apply hash indices. We have seen briefly what that is. Now the database system can make use of hash indices. They are very good for point queries, but the downside is that they are not applicable at all to range queries. So if we have like a range as illustrated earlier, let's say the ID should be bigger than 42, then the index cannot be used. The database system cannot use the index to accelerate the access to tuples. Hence, we have to go back to a linear search, which is expensive. Right. Then search via primary and clustering index, considering that we have these illustrations in mind again, like the B+ tree, and then we set like primary index. And clustering index means that the sorting order here of the data on disk is the same as the key that is used to create the index. This is very helpful if you have range queries. It's very efficient then, because you can just sequentially read here without too many random accesses to the hard drive. And we have also classified these into sparse and non-sparse, and we have seen that primary indices are sparse. Then secondary indices are also possible. The good thing, or like the thing that makes it very flexible, is that you can have multiple secondary indices because they are independent of the sorting order of the data on disk. The primary clustering indices, there can only be one because they have to be aligned with the sorting order on the disk, and we know that every file can have only one sorting order. But for secondary indices, this constraint is not there. So we can have multiple ones. But as we have discussed already, since they are non-clustered, they can be expensive when it comes to particular to range queries. So overall, we can phrase the following guidelines for creating indices or for not creating indices. And these guidelines here are taken from a book or from the book by Ramakrishnan and Gerke. So the first guideline is very obvious: to index or not to index. But the question is, do we need the index at all? Is there any query that can benefit from it? Because if there's no query that can benefit from it, why would we create it? Because creating an index also means that you have to invest time or effort to keep the index up to date. Not you are doing this, but the database system is doing this. And if you have many updates, inserts, or deletions inside the database coming from, let's say, customers that want to reserve a movie, you have to update the indices. And this is costly, or can be costly. So if you don't need it, don't create it. Second guideline, choice of search key. How do you find the suitable key over which you want to create the index? This is not very difficult. Well, the guideline is not very difficult to understand, because you have to look at the WHERE clause of your SQL query to see which attributes are used there. Then you see how are the attributes used. Is it the point query or is it the range query? If it's a point query, then you can use a hash index. Is it a range query? Now, we have seen that hash indices are not working with range queries. They're not supporting them. So then you have to go and use a B plus tree. Guideline 3, indices over multiple attributes. That is composite indices. We have seen that in this example of this movie rental with Elm Street and Arizona and Jensen. If you're looking at the where clause and you see that there's a predicate involving multiple attributes of a relation, you can consider creating such an index to speed up the retrieval. Sometimes these indices also allow that the query can be answered only by looking at the index, so you don't have to go to the data file at all. These queries are called index-only queries. Guideline 4, many times discussed already, a relation can be only sorted in one way. So there can be only one index of this relation which is clustered. Yeah. If you have a range queries benefit most from clustering. So the rule of thumb says if you have a range query, create a clustered index, or if you have a frequently occurring range query, then you should create a clustered index for the attribute used for this in this range. And if there are multiple range queries, you should go for the one again, which is often used, and also looking at the selectivity, because if you have a range query where you're retrieving only 5 tuples, it's probably okay to have a non-clustered index because getting these 5 tuples costs 5 disk accesses. But if you're retrieving 5,000 tuples, and remember this back of the envelope calculation for the cost of accessing sorted data using a non-clustered index, then this can be very costly. Right? Then you should go for a clustering index instead of a non-clustered index. So these are trade-offs. Again, these are guidelines only. There's not any cost model here that would suggest that one or the other is better. It's a mixture out of selectivity and frequencies, and then also some experience, which of the indices are useful and which one are not useful. Guideline 5, hash index versus tree index. So usually the tree index is preferred because it can handle range queries as well as point queries. That's a good thing. But the hash index is very good if you have, well, no range query, obviously, and you have a very important, very frequently occurring point query. For instance, later on we will see how to implement joins inside a database system. We will talk about an index-based nested loop join. I don't want to explain this in detail now, but there we will see that we can greatly benefit from a hash index if we create it on the inner relation of this index-based nested loop join. But more about this later in a few slides. Guideline 6. What about updates? So if you create an index which is not useful, it's only causing trouble, it's only causing work. Even so the index is useful for the query processing, it does not mean that the overall performance of the database system will be greatly improved. If your database system is rarely queried but often updated, you might want to think twice before you're creating an index. Right? It's even in the extreme case sometimes possible or feasible to drop an index from a table when you're expecting a lot of updates to the table and recreate it afterwards. So if you have a huge table and an index on it, and you have very many updates per second, or a whole bulk of them, then keeping the keeping the index up to date all the time is expensive. Right? So you then, if you're wondering why your updates are so slow, then reconsider and see which indices you have created, and perhaps you want to get rid of one of them, and then after the updates are loaded to the database, you can recreate it if it's needed. Otherwise, of course, not. So this somehow sounds like the only cause in trouble for updates, but it's not true, because they also can be helpful for updates that can boost the performance. An example, for instance, would be you want to, in your application that is talking to the database, you often want to update student records. And your form that the user is using takes as input the student ID and then has to retrieve all the information of a student so you can change it. And this means that you have to find the student first of all. And this is up and this can be improved by creating an index on matriculation number. Right? And then we can find the student record efficiently, update it, and write it back. Without this index, there would be the need to go through the entire relation of the students and find the one that has the student ID we are looking for. And if you have an index on the student ID, we can do this much quicker. So all of this needs to be considered when deciding which indexes are useful and need to be created. So it's not that simple that you have a relation, let's say, with three attributes and another one with four attributes, and then you say, oh, okay, I have enough disk space, let's create all possible indices over these. And some of them might be totally useless, and overall the performance of the system will be worse. If you have a database system which is very rarely updated, you can tolerate more indices, of course, but if you have a database system which is often updated, you have to think twice very carefully which index is really required. And based now on the overall indices we have created, the database is able to compute for a join or for like a query plan, but perhaps involving joins and so on can be very complicated. Database system has to decide how to execute this query plan, and there it's important for the data access to know which indices are existing. And again, also if you have a join in your query plan and you have an index on a certain attribute that is used in the join, and then the database system has the option to execute the join using this so-called index-based nested loop join. Otherwise, if there's no index, you cannot execute an index-based nested loop join without an index, right? So then you have to go to different other ways how to execute a join. So indices are really important for performance and also fastly influence the decision made by the query optimizer inside the database system. So let's have a look at this concrete example. We have two relations here, employees and departments. So employees describing information about people employed in a company, and departments describes who is the manager of the department, what is the department ID, and so on. Here in this query, we want to find all the employee names together with the name of the manager of the department, where the department name should be Toy. So let's have a look how we can identify which index or which indices we should create. Let's have a look at the where clause in order to do so. This is a conjunction consisting of two predicates. Department name should be Toy, and this one here is important to make the join between the two relations. So the employee department number should be equal to the department number of the department table. Yeah, this is like the way you would write the join. So now let's start with this one here. We are interested in department with the name Toy. This can be, of course, for future queries, different department names. But in this case, it's Toy. In general, it would be, if you're thinking about Java prepared statements, this would be like a placeholder variable here. Now here in this example, it's toy. So now, which index is useful to speed up this retrieval, this lookup? Well, ideally we create an index on the department name for the relation departments. And then we can efficiently find those department tuples with name equals the given parameter, here toy. So we have the relation D for the departments, and we have the department ID, or here it's called, to be precise, DNO, department number, and here we have the department name, and perhaps more other attributes. So now the index now is very effective to find the tuple, or multiple tuples in general, that have the name department equal toy. When we get the tuple, then we also get the other attributes, the department number, and even here the ones in the end that we don't really need for this example. So we get the department number, let's say it's 42. And then this 42 can be used to find those employees where the employee department number is 42. Which index do we need to do this, to support this? Well, we create an index on E department number. And then we can use this 42 as input and use the index to effectively retrieve the employee tuples with this department number. Okay, so we have already two indices created. What else? What about D.department number? Do we have to create an index there as well? No, we don't have to. It would be of no use, at least not for this query, because when we use the name index based on the attribute department name, in this case looking up for toy, we have already this information of the department number, so we don't have to look up in D again something with department number. It's just not needed. So we don't need that index on D.department number. So overall, we have an index on D name of the departments table and on department number of the employees table. And then the index or the query can be efficiently processed. Yeah, this is exactly what I have said. So we see that it's pretty simple at a first glance, but then if you're only looking at the queries here, you would have maybe decided to create also an index on this one, which in fact would not be useful to evaluate the query, right? So it takes a bit care to see really what's going on. And later on, when we talk about how the actual operators, like join operators and so on, are implemented, then this will give you even more insights to understand in which circumstances which index can be used by which algorithm, and if this is efficient or not.